The road to the NEC Women's Basketball Championship ends tonight here in Hamden. Tonight, the Quinnipiac Bobcats are playing for a perfect conference season and their first ever tournament title. On the other side, the St. Francis Red Flash are looking to add to their already crowded trophy case with championship trophy number 12. It's the 2013 NEC Women's Basketball Championship game, and we're counting it down to tip-off next on NEC Front Row Live. This is NEC Front Row Live, brought to you by Pilot Pen. Tonight, the top-seeded Quinnipiac Bobcats match up against the four-seeded St. Francis Red Flash with the NEC Championship and an automatic ticket to the NCAA tournament on the line. And hello, everyone. Welcome to our courtside baseline set here at the TD Bank Sports Center. I'm Craig D'Amico along with Coach Phyllis Mangina. Glad you could be along with us, Coach. You have Quinnipiac playing for the perfect season. St. Francis trying to win their 12th tournament title. This should be a good one.
This should be a terrific game. This journey for Quinnipiac started in the summertime when they took their team to Italy. And they've won it another 21 straight games. Everyone expected them to be here. It's St. Francis who's really that unexpected team, but they've got the championship DNA. This should be an exciting matchup.
Right now, let's jump right into it and check out our top headlines. We start with Quinnipiac. They are going for history, looking to complete just the fifth perfect conference regular season plus tournament championship in league history. They would join the 1987 Monmouth Hawks, the 94 Mount St. Mary's Mountaineers, the 04 Red Flash, and the 2009 Sacred Heart Pioneers as the only teams to run the table through the regular season and finish it off with a tournament title. In 15 years, the Bobcats have never won a championship. They've had great players, great teams, but they've always have fallen just short. Today, perhaps with their most special team they've ever assembled, they have a chance to get the job done, standing in their way, the 11-time tournament champion St. Francis Red Flash, the most accomplished team in the NEC postseason record books. Moving on, let's take a look at some of the All-Conference Award winners. We have a bunch of them involved in this game. Features St. Francis junior Allie Williams, second in the league in points, fourth in rebounds, as well as Quinnipiac's Felicia Barron, who's also now a two-time Defensive Player of the Year. The Brenda Riley Coach of the Year Award goes to Quinnipiac's Trisha Fabri. Go 18-0. You probably do get a couple Coach of the Year votes, and she takes home the award, like I said, for the third straight season. Also, St. Francis, they're spending the week here in the Nutmeg State. And for more on that, we send it over to the third member of our crew. Let's go over to the sidelines and check in with Marc Robbins.
Now, with the travel situation of a six-hour bus ride back and forth to Loretto, St. Francis decided to stay here in the Nutmeg State for the next few days. So they have been dealing with study halls and hotels, getting cramped and sick of looking at each other in hotel rooms. So they've gone to the movies. They've gotten out and about. It's a real fine line that they're trying to walk, not thinking too much about a championship game appearance and a possible berth in the NCAA tournament, and being fully prepared to take on the top-seeded Bobcats of Quinnipiac. It's a daunting task. We'll see how they do a little bit later on. Back to you, Craig.
Marc, thank you very much. Now, yesterday here, final preparations were going on here at the TD Bank Sports Center. Both the Bobcats and St. Francis had their final team practices, and both coaches were nice enough to be mic'd up for us. So right now, let's take a special inside access look at St. Francis head coach Joe Hay and Quinnipiac head coach Trisha Fabri mic'd up.
Who are you on, Aisha? Aisha, who's your guarding? Okay, so you can help off that.
So get yourself up the line here to help if the ball goes here. Hand off. That's a handoff, that's a screen. Ball screen, hug and under. Hand off.
Third man
stuff. You would be guarding the ball screen or the post up. Lex Wills, you guys hear that? Now the issue?
Okay.
And with with you. The issue we get in with you a lot of times is getting flat to the baseline. Now you're stunting down here and there's a clear path here. Same with you. So you got to be up. If you're up here, now it's not clear. Not a clear lane.
I might be Martin at the end of the game, Shay. Good. Good, Lex. Good work. Good. Good job, Belle. Way to work. One time, Rob. Good, Aisha. Good job. Here we go, Wills. You're not tired. Can't be tired now. Oh, good job, Sparks. It's scary. Oh, you got me. Good. All right, this end, this end.
Going all right? Oh, that's good practice for you. It's a good opportunity to be happy about it. Remember that, Brooklyn, for your book, right? Who was that that just shot it? Who was that that just shot it? That was Martin, wasn't it? Oh, it's Mary, Barton, Baron, blah, blah, blah. From. Let's go, talk, Gray. Talk, Gray. Okay, your feet weren't set. You're pushing, falling away. Just get your feet set, shoot it up. Nah, you're fine, Wills. I'm sure your elbow wasn't in, though, but you're good. It's much better, Lex. Get your feet under you. You're great. Yeah. I watch film. So what's the best spot? Hey, when we're running next, what's the best spot to be in? You got foul there? Everybody off the line. Everybody off the line. No time left. Lane violation. Yeah, just put 3 minutes up there. I need 3 minutes to give, you know, some brilliant speech here before the end of the practice. So I feel like I did something, then we'll go back to the hotel. It's all over. I got all kinds of stuff highlighted on here. You know, Shanae played a great game against Sacred Heart, right? Pretty darn good. You handled the ball against pressure. You rebounded, you defended. Your numbers were nothing, 1.4 rebounds. But we don't win without you and your composure at the end. I already talked to Kia about her composure. Pulling the basketball out. All right, you didn't score much, Kia. 3 points, that's 3 rebounds, 7 points. We make a lot of mistakes, but the way that you guys handled those mistakes against Central and against Sacred Heart, that's what's going to determine the championship game. Again, we missed 40 shots in here, 48 shots, and we're still in the game. So if you get stressed, if you're worrying about something, everybody's going to make mistakes. Everybody's going to miss shots. We missed 48 shots here, and we were in the game with 4 minutes to go. I don't think we're missing 48 shots tomorrow. All right, let's go.
Gotta be aggressive.
Let's go, ladies.
Aggressive, that's the word.
Let's go.
Gotta be aggressive.
Together, 1, 2, 3.
Together.
Handle it, handle it, handle it, blue. Handle it, blue. Attack. 2-on-2, keep attacking. Who's filling? Face. Face. Lay it in. Stay with it. Good battle. I like the nail polish. When'd you get that done?
What?
My clovers. Oh my gosh, you're beautiful.
I got it Thursday.
I was almost gonna get Quinnipiac put on all my nails. No. Q-U-I-N and I was going to, but I never had time to get in there. But I was, maybe for the NCAAs were there.
That would be awesome. I know, I was like, I want
Buffett to Buffett move off
on
Notre Dame.
First.
Yeah. No. And those two colors look good together. Because Muffet McGraw at Notre Dame always had Notre Dame on her nails, and like, if I ever get there, I'm gonna do that, so. Got a front, got a rebound, ladies! Switch it up one last time, ladies. We gotta talk. We gotta talk, ladies. Gotta talk. Gotta defend the three-point line. Gotta defend the three-point line. Get back first. We're going back to our transition D. Roll the ball. It's gotta be better. We get it done the right the one time, then we're done doing it. Come on, you've got to talk. You've got to sprint back the last two. Three people got to stop the ball strong side of the floor. Got to get it right. We've got to get it right. Nick, same thing. Get right on Katie's shoulder when she's setting that screen. Get right on that shoulder. Get right on top of that. One step up there. Good, you're there. Good. Up, switch that. Hop her up. Good. Get back. It's good to be anxious and excited and nervous for tomorrow, but let's not be we haven't been all year and be all in, all of us, all the time, one possession. One possession. It's going to be a war. It is not going to be easy. Anything good is never easy. Tomorrow we're going to see challenges and we're going to give challenges. But be at our best. Be at our best. Play harder. Play together. Take care of the basketball. Do what we've done. We've worked really, really, really hard to get to 29-2. 29-2. And are 40 minutes away from winning the championship. 40 minutes away from making history. And we've talked about it. And you guys are ready. You are ready. Ready to go, have a good focus, have a good mindset, how we're going to play, how we're going to defend, where Williams is, how we're going to check, how we're going to rebound. Do what we do, but have fun with it. All right? Have fun with it. Enjoy it. Enjoy the morning. Enjoy today. Enjoy the moment. All right? Going forward. Because you never know when we're going to get here again. You never know when we're going to get here again. But we're here now, and we need to make the most of it and be who we've been. And do what we do and have a fire and an excitement to go out and do it. Now, I want you guys to really take it easy the rest of the day. I want you off your feet. All right? We said legs are a little tired. Can't happen now. This is for what we want. There's no fatigue. All right? We're ready to go. Off our feet. We relax. We unwind. We enjoy each other. Enjoy the moment. And then we get up tomorrow. We're ready for championship Sunday. Bring it home. All right, do it together. Come on.
Yes! Yes!
Team on three. One, two, three.
Team.
Craig D'Amico, Phyllis Mangina back here courtside on NEC Front Row Live, counting down to the NEC Women's Basketball Championship game at the top of the hour on ESPNU. Coach, we saw the inside access there. Two contrasting styles with the way both coaches kind of delivered their messages.
Well, Craig, I love the sneak peek. Not many people get to be in that practice, especially the day before a championship game. And you can see the two distinct styles, but you have to be who you are with your team. They both know their players. They both have terrific success. And you can see just how they go. They play back and forth. They try to keep things a little bit light before a game like today. Just a terrific look inside their practices.
Now, right after yesterday's practice, Coach Fabri went from being coach to being mom. She actually went out to go check in with her daughter, Carly, who was playing in the state finals here in Connecticut. And for more on that, we sent it over to the sidelines and check in with Marc Robbins.
Craig and Phyllis, as if preparing for a championship game and a first ever bid in the NCAA tournament isn't pressure enough, Quinnipiac head coach Tricia Fabri had to deal with being the mom of a high school star going for a state title. Last night, Trisha's daughter, Carly, led her Laurelton Hall squad in the Class LL Connecticut State Final against a Mercy squad, and the game was fantastic. I happened to be on the call of that game, and it came down to the last few seconds, and Carly Fabri's team took the lead with 3.8 seconds to go, only to see the opposition throw a three-quarter court pass to one player who fed another for a three to win the game. So Tricia Fabri has had to deal with preparing her team and now helping console her daughter on a heartbreaking loss. And she says that it has been heartbreaking, and it will, of course, a victory will certainly help heal some of the wounds, but not all, certainly for a mother who's aching for her child. Back to you guys.
All right, Marc, thank you so much. Phyllis, you know, Coach Fabri told me earlier in the week she's more nervous as a mom watching in the stands than being on the sidelines and coaching her team.
That's because she has absolutely no control but what happened in the high school game.
Right.
Little more control of the college game, but again, she's not out there playing. But what a great year for her daughter and a great way to share this great sport of basketball together. I know they've really gone through things, talked to Trish about this throughout the season. I've known her daughter since she's grown up, so a heartbreaking loss. The family hopes it's not the same way here this afternoon.
They'll try to salvage the weekend here with the championship tonight. Now let's take a look at each team's road to the finals. We'll start with the St. Francis Red Flash, a team that won 17 games this year. They started 7-2, but they hit a roadblock at the halfway point, finished 3-6. In the quarterfinals, they got past Central Connecticut in the final 30 seconds, 66-63. And then in the semifinal round, they had lost 9 of 10 to the Pioneers, hadn't won at Sacred Heart since 2005, but they poured in 46 first-half points and won that game 83-67. Right now, let's take a special inside look at some of the semifinal highlights.
And Sparks on the drive, gets her own rebound. Open three. Can't leave Allie Williams open. Baseline drive. Morgan Merriman, two basket. Norman, right around Garangelo. Finds the open Konashevsky. She's not going to miss a second. Three, Konashevsky. Open three. Alexa Hayward. Trains it. And St. Francis is doubling up Sacred Heart, 7.5 minutes in, 18-9. But Sparks fires the three. Rebecca Sparks, her first three of the game. She has five. Allie Williams open again.
And the problem for Ed Swanson right now is this game could get so far away from him before this half ends. They're down 20.
Erica Norman, look at that speed, breaks it all by herself in the finish. She's going to have to do something. 3 seconds, nine clock, high arcing, three off the glass, and it falls. And that's the type of half it's been. A 20-point lead, 46-26. Glance, finds Berryman, nails the 16-footer. And Allie Williams, they're paying a lot of attention to her. Drives right into that zone. Contact, and it counts. Three-pointer for Norman. You knew the Pioneers were going to make a run. This could be it. Leads down to 15. Now Norman resets, but only five to shoot. There's the screen. Drives left. Layup. Good. And here comes Sacred Heart, Gabrielle Washington. Launches the three. Got it. And the lead is as small as it's been for a long time. 63-53. It's down to 10 with 5:38 to play. Gibbs takes it herself. Layup on the fake pass. What a move. But they get the offensive rebound. Sparks the three.
That's a dagger. And that puts a big hole in the heart of Sacred Heart Pioneers.
The Red Flash are heading to Quinnipiac on Sunday. Tip off at 5 o'clock to play for the NEC Championship.
Here's Chicky. Chicky up the floor in transition. Gives it up for Brewer, who knocks it down and puts the mound on top by three. Alicia Barron, the two-time Defensive Player of the Year, with the swipe and the score. And right now it's 16-15, the mound up by one. Here's Jasmine Martin trying to sneak her way through, and she drives in from the left and knocks it in off the square. Trying to go to Guastella, but it was knocked away from behind by Grossen, and she'll have an open, uncontested layup on the other end. Hoffman in the corner. Brewer back in the game, and there's her fourth triple of the night. On the road, the sixth seed, leading unbeaten in conference Quinnipiac, the regular season champion, 34-29. Down low, Martin forces it up and got the ball to go through off the glass and in. Brewer in the corner,
Try to pass it back out, but it's intercepted by Felicia Barron, who takes it in for the layup. Quinnipiac has been to this stage before. Oh, here's Jasmine Martin right on cue, knocking down a three. Jasmine Martin, a 16-foot jumper. She now has 20. Pass it back to her left, now down low. McQueen trying to get around Matthews, and it goes through. Give and go, Brewer and Lowe's for three, and it rattles home. Six threes on the night. Trying to drive it herself, a little spin move, got around the defender and knocks it in. 55-52, Bobcats in front, looking for a spot in Sunday's final. 90 seconds to play in regulation. They go to Lonergan again, blocked by Guastella. Abshire's first free throw attempt rattles out, but how about Guastella getting in there, wrapping up the rebound, and Coach Fabry gets the timeout. On the shot clock, wide open look, Felicia Barron for three. No good, but McQueen skies for the rebound, and she gets it, throwing it back outside the perimeter to Abshire. Bobcats, a team that seemingly has all the pieces to the puzzle. Coach Fabry says that Abshire is the most important piece. She calmly knocks down two free throws. Stella will hold on to it. The clock hits zero and the ball game is over. The Bobcats have booked their date with destiny. For just the second time in history, they're headed to the NEC Championship game.
You're watching NEC Front Row Live, brought to you by Pilot Pen. The fans beginning to file into the TD Bank Sports Center. The atmosphere is starting to build. The energy is starting to build here as we get close to championship time. Again, we're counting it down to tip-off at the top of the hour on ESPNU. Now, you saw St. Francis. You also saw Quinnipiac in their semifinal win. Let's take a look at the Bobcats' road here to the finals, because it's been a pretty dominant one. 29-2, 18-0. They haven't lost since losing a non-conference game against Hartford in late December. They claim their second ever conference championship. They're the sixth team to run the table in the NEC regular season, going the entire way without losing a game. And they've done it dominantly, as I mentioned. They've won by an average margin of 17 points, and they've only had one game this year decided by three possessions or less. In the quarterfinal round, they defeated Bryant 79-55, and then in the semifinals, as you saw, they had to make up a halftime deficit, but they came back to beat Mount St. Mary 63-56. Phyllis, let's take a second to go back and talk about the Red Flash first. They're a team that, you know, after they went through their, you know, stumbling block, the midseason point, maybe not a lot of people factored in that they would be able to make it here. But it just goes to show you, anything can happen in the NEC tournament.
Well, you have to just understand, you know, Allie Williams is a constant first team all Northeast Conference player. It's a double-double every night, and she's really carried this Red Flash team. But it's been the emergence and the consistency of Nakia Gibbs. She's at about 10 points a game, but it's been that third scorer that they found in this championship games that has really sparked them. I say sparked because of Rebecca Spark, 27 points at Sacred Heart. I mean, that's the third scorer that they have found. And the other thing is their defense really picked up, but it's that third scorer that they found in Sparks, and then Dugan in the Central Connecticut game that really gave them that edge.
This is their 15th final. 15 of the last 20 years they've played for an NEC championship. They've won 11 times. They've won 37 of their last 39 playoff games. And that's a streak going back to 1996. So, you know, they have had a lot of success here at this stage. On the other hand, for Quinnipiac, they're just in their second ever championship game. They've had a lot of tough breaks in postseasons past, but no doubt about it, this is a very special team that Coach Fabry has here in 2013.
Well, I think some of those past heartaches have really kind of, you know, made this team that much tougher and that much stronger. It's a very close group. They play very well together, but I think the key for them, even they've led the league in scoring, has been what they have done defensively. Last year, they were giving up almost 63 points a game. This year, they're at 57 points. Also, their assist turnover ratio, the second team in the country, assist turnover. So they've played much better defensively. They can really take care of the basketball. And I think those are the keys, and that's why we see them sitting where they are today.
Their only other championship appearance was in 2006 when they lost to their Merritt Parkway rivals, the Sacred Heart Pioneers, in a very close championship game. Now, as we mentioned, we have both head coaches. We had a chance to sit down with both of them yesterday here at practice. So let's check in with first-year head man for the Red Flash, Joe Hay, and then the 18-year veteran for Quinnipiac, Tricia Fabry.
Coach, this is your first year as the head coach of St. Francis. Coming to a program with so much history and tradition, with high expectations. So what's it like to step into a head coach's role for a program that expects to be here every year?
Well, it's tough. There's a lot of pressure, you know, but we do expect to be there
you know, it was very helpful. I was really lucky to be an assistant and have gone through, you know, the last four seasons there. So we've had a lot of success. We've been here, you know, in this spot before. But it is, you know, it is, there's a lot more pressure. You know, you hear, you know, you're kind of expected to be here, and it might have been a disappointment if we didn't get here, but you know, I think we had a great season though.
Now you got off to a great start at 7-2, and then at the halfway point, and then there was a stumble, finished 3-6. What was the stumbles and the roadblocks that got into you at the halfway point?
Well, seasons are a long time. You know, we started on September 1 with conditioning. It's 7 months of being together. You know, so October 1 practice, 6 months. You know, and you get into that time in February, and there's a lot of ups and downs. You know, you have 15 players together, coaching staff, and sometimes sometimes people get tired of each other. You know, maybe I think our chemistry might have suffered a little bit during those times. We also played tough teams, so whenever we played Sacred Heart or Quinnipiac, then we didn't do so good during the regular season. So that was a piece of it. Played two tough teams, and it's just kind of an emotional roller coaster through the season. And we got to the end of the season, and I think it's just kind of maybe became a grind a little bit, and our energy suffered and fell off, and then we were able.
Is it coming together now though for tournament time?
Well, you don't play like we did Wednesday without some. The key with our team is energy level and playing together. And when we're not on the same page, it's not pretty to watch. So, you mentioned how we've had some real good games and then we drop off. We've had some games where we've scored in the 50s. But when we play together and we're all focused and we're all on the same page, like we were against Sacred Heart, we're a pretty good team.
You probably needed an effort like that against Quinnipiac in the final, because they're a pretty good team. So when you game plan against the Bobcats, where do you start?
You start by not paying attention to how good they are. They're 29-2. They are a very, very good team. And the first time we played them, we turned the ball over 31 times against them. They kind of had their way with us. The second game here, we had a little bit more success. But they're a great team. They're on a huge roll. They've been consistent all year. It's really, really impressive for a team to go unbeaten in our conference. And as far as game planning, they got great players. And they're 10 deep. They play a lot of people, maybe more than 10, I don't know. But we really are focused on the top, 5, 6, 7. We have to try and limit touches and scoring opportunities for Martin and Barron. And then by doing that, then you're ignoring McQueen, who's a second-team All-League player and one of the best post players in the league. So they have three really good pieces in that, and then if you want to call them role players or there are other starters. I think I heard Coach Fabri talk about Abshire and how she's kind of the motor, the one that really kind of puts everything together for mm-hmm. them. And we recruited her a little bit out of high school. I've seen her play for a long time. She's a great point guard. And then their fours can step out and shoot the ball. They can score on you. They can rebound. They're just a solid, well-rounded team.
Last question. What would it mean to you in your first year to bring title number 12 to an already crowded trophy case in Loretto?
Well, getting to this point was almost more of a relief than, it's hard to say. Personally, anytime you can win a championship, it's amazing. And I think, when Coach Selhorst and I first got here, 5 years ago, we were kind of going through a drought. And in our first year, we made it to the championship game. That was really exciting. And then we won two after that. And it's really kind of a crazy feeling. I was thinking about it a little bit this morning. It's almost like we're just going about our business every day. So every practice, we're still, what we did today was really very consistent to what we did back in October with kind of the same message. And I'm just really, really lucky, really fortunate. I think about the opportunities that we have and to be able to compete on this stage and play for championships. And I got to remind myself not to take it for granted, because there's a lot of lot of coaches who've coached for a number of years, you know, that never get to this position. And I was watching a thing on Paul Westhead last night, actually, and how he won a championship in his first year with the Lakers coaching. And, you know, you think it's going to come easy, and then he said it was 21 years before he won another championship. And that's when he coached the Mercury. And so that was kind of a reminder to me that it's, you know, don't get caught up too much in it, but really be thankful for the opportunity.
Now you go from coaching and teaching in high school just a couple years ago to now the NEC Championship game. Coach, best of luck to you.
Well, thank you, Craig.
Coach, we're getting close to game time here in the NEC Championship. Now, this is your 18th year with the Bobcats, 14th year you've been in the NEC tournament. But how special is this year's team that you're taking into the final?
Special is an understatement with what we've been able to achieve, getting to 29-2 and hosting an NEC title game. We've been working really hard all season long to get to this point. It's really great that we're in the game. March 17th has been circled on the calendar for quite some time. But we're anxious to get it going, and we know a lot of nerves and will be flowing. But we're going to settle down once that ball goes in the air, and I'm sure it's going to be a great game.
Talk a little bit about your style of play this year. We know how everybody contributes. We talked to some of your players already about that. Where did that philosophy come from? Where did that breed from? And obviously it's had tremendous success over the course of the year.
Yeah, well, a roster has dictated just a lot of talent that we've had. We were able to go over to Italy during the summer, and we had 15 healthy bodies at the time, and we were able just to, you know, divide them into three groups of five, just because we didn't want roles defined when we were taking a great trip over to Italy, and just rotated, you know, each team starting, each team playing a couple of minutes, and out of that really just was born that, you know what, we've got a lot of players with a lot of talent. This depth could be something really special. And it really turned out to be a really big reason why we were able to have the success that we've had this season.
And it's been a historic season already, completing a perfect regular season, 18-0 during the regular season, now 2-0 here in the tournament. You're looking to join a select company, four teams, you're trying to be the fifth, have run the table throughout the entire season and won the tournament. You've coached against two of them, the 04 Red Flash and the 09 Pioneers. So let's play fantasy basketball for a second.
Oh my gosh.
How do you think that your team would match up with Swink and
Swink and Sawinski
were just,
yeah, we're fantastic players. I mean, really dominant in terms of size. I again like our depth and how we want to play pressure and pace on the ball. So they've had some heck of seasons and some great players, but I do like how our style of play over a course of 40 minutes tends to wear teams down and a little bit fresher legs down the stretch. But the Swink teams are just fantastic and dominating, and obviously Ed Swanson's Sawinski team with Apo were just great teams as well. And we're excited to be maybe join that company if we're able to come through on Sunday night.
Now this year's St. Francis team possesses some challenges as well. Allie Williams, and they do a little bit of a press. So how do you go about countering some of those things that they do?
Well, first of all, we want to make sure that we're fundamentally sound in what we want to do and not change who we are. We don't want to change 29 wins too much, but we know that they're a really great team, and they've played a heck of a game against Sacred Heart in Central Connecticut. They come in really hot. Allie Williams is just a special player who can do it all on both ends of the floor. Great defensive player, I think probably an underrated defensive player. But they had Sparks really get hot the other night from the guard position. Their style of play is a lot like our style of play. We want to go up and down. So I anticipate a real high-scoring game, but a real good game for basketball fans to watch.
Now, for you, you know, we mentioned you've been here a long time, 18 years, but you know, this is maybe the most special team that you've had. No offense to any of the other great players that have come through your program. Opportunities like this don't come around that often. So how important, how special is it to finish the journey the right way in your eyes by winning the championship on Sunday night?
Well, I think it's just, you know, not us trying to lose anything, it's us going to get it. And I think we've talked about that just a little bit at the end of practice today, just to go in and compete. And that's where we're at our best. When we've been practicing, if we don't put a time and a score, you know, we're not competing, but we go out and compete. I just want us to be who we've been, be aggressive. The team has been so special. We've seen a lot of different scenarios. I think that prepared us well for these 40 minutes that lie before us. And it's going to be a great challenge in St. Francis of Pennsylvania, but I think it's one we're ready, and we're going to see a great basketball game for 40 minutes.
Well, Coach, best of luck to you, and we look forward to a great final.
Thanks, Craig.
We welcome you back live here on NEC Front Row Live. We have Joe Hay, who is trying to become just the third St. Francis first-year head coach to win the championship in his initial campaign. He's the first ever male head coach in program history. Jill Poe is the last first-year NEC women's basketball coach to win the championship in year one. She did it back in 2004. And of course, Coach Fabry is trying to, after 18 years at the helm of the program, 15 in the Northeast Conference, win the program's very first NEC championship. We're joined here on set by not only Coach Phyllis Mangina, but by the commissioner of the Northeast Conference, Noreen Morris. Commissioner Noreen, happy St. Patrick's Day and welcome to the NEC Final.
Thank you. Thanks for being here. This is a great venue. Crowds coming in. It's going to be a good day.
Now let's talk a little bit about NEC women's basketball because it's a very exciting time. Just a couple of years ago, it was 27th out of 31 in terms of conference RPI. The last few years, it's grown. Last year was 15th. This year, again, it's in the high 20s. So it really must be an exciting time for the NEC and for its women's basketball.
Our programs have done a wonderful job building their programs, and last year we saw the results of that at the 15 mark for our conference RPI. And if you look across the board, we have fabulous coaches, Coach Fabry, Joe. Hey, he's been here for a while underneath the former coach, but we've got a tremendous group of coaches who are fully committed to the NEC. When they get together for their annual coaches meetings, they are talking all about how do we make this league better, what can we do as a group. They are all in, and the results are showing.
Noreen, we talked a little bit off camera just about, having exposure. Just talk a little bit about what the Front Row has done, not just for women's basketball, for all your sports in the Northeast Conference.
Yeah, the Front Row has been a fantastic addition to what we've been doing to try to enhance the NEC brand as well as basketball. Each of our institutions has the opportunity to webcast any of the sports that they can physically and electronically do. So we not only do we basketball, football, volleyball, softball, bowling, swimming, everybody has an opportunity to webcast, and we're doing it. If you haven't, obviously you're watching it now, but we have the multi-viewer so that you can view upwards of 5 and 6 events at once. We have the social media attached to it so you can follow what's happening and what folks are talking about. So it's a one of a kind within the Division I conferences, and our staff has done a great job. Ron Ratner was the architect of this, and it was a vision we had 2 years ago. And with the help of PAC Network, we've come to fruition, and we launched August 17th, I believe, and to nothing but rave reviews from our coaches, our student athletes, and our fans.
And Noreen, we'll get you out of here on this. We expect to see a great final here. You have Quinnipiac trying for a perfect conference season, and then of course St. Francis trying to add to their already illustrious history in the NEC record books. What do you expect to see here today?
This is going to be a battle. As you said, both teams come in with the different. Quinnipiac going for the 21st straight win. They've only been here twice. So this will be their second time in the championship game. St. Francis U, this is their 15th time with 11 wins under the belt. But, you've got two different teams. St. Francis U came out on fire against Sacred Heart. I was at that game last week. And
46 points in the first half.
Unbelievable. It was a great first half. They were shooting lights out. So if they can come out on fire with that much energy, Quinnipiac is deep. So you got to be able to play 40 minutes.
Yeah, great balance.
So we'll see what happens. I'm hoping for a good game for two halves and come down to the wire. That's what I'm looking for.
We all, Noreen, thanks for joining us here on Front Row Live.
Great. Thanks very much for being here.
We'll see the commissioner again during the post-game show. She'll be handing out the championship trophy to whoever comes out of today's contest. Now, right now, we had a chance yesterday during practice to check in with some of the key players in today's game. Allie Williams, a first-team all-conference performer for St. Francis, second in the league in points, fourth in rebounding. Just one of three St. Francis players with 1,000 points, 600 rebounds, 200 steals. The other two, Beth Swink and Justin Noble, are all NEC Hall of Famers. On the other side, we have Jack Martin, who is the second-half hero for the PAC in the semifinal game. So right now, let's take a special inside look at some interviews conducted yesterday with Allie Williams, All-NEC third-team performer, Jack Martin.
Now, Allie, before we start, in the interest of disclosure, I should tell my players this year. Now, that doesn't mean anything, but my vote, factor in what anybody else did. If you just look at the player of the year.
Artemis Benu is a great player, and I don't think you can look past 16 rebounds a game and 19 points, but she's a really good player. But we have a lot of good players in our league that could have had player of the year. It just, I'll accept first team because that's a big honor, and I'm really happy.
And I'm sure you would like to have tournament MVP as well, the way that your team is playing. Talk about the way that your team has played here, winning a close game at Central in the first round, and then, you know, really exploding offensively in that semifinal against Sacred Heart.
I think we finally just came together and realized we can't do it individually. We have to do it as a team, and we've had a roller coaster season. We've had our ups, our downs, and I think we're really coming together well at the right time, and we can really, really do something special this season.
Now, your roster has a bunch of players who were with the team 2 years ago, the last time you went to the NCAA tournament. So how much of a factor and of an advantage is that experience?
I think it's a huge experience, or a huge advantage, because we know how fun it can be getting to the tournament, getting the free stuff, and getting to be on TV. It's so fun, and I think that's kind of motivating to get back to that place. And I mean, we've won, I think, 11 championships going for our 12th, and it's like motivating to keep the tradition alive.
Well, I see you with the playoff purple, the traditional St. Francis playoff purple. What is it like, you know, knowing about the history and the tradition and knowing that you can contribute to it, you know, if you guys were to bring home title number 12 on Sunday?
Yeah, I mean, it's nice to do it for our fans and the alumni that have built the tradition up and built the program to what it is. And we want to win for them. We want to win for everyone who supported us and who's built the legacy. So it's motivating just to do it for the St. Francis community.
Now, you've played Quinnipiac twice this year, just like you played Sacred Heart twice this year, and things didn't go their way, but you turned it around for the third time. So what does Quinnipiac, you know, what's some of the things that they do well that you might try to turn around here this third time?
Quinnipiac's a great team, and they've stayed composed. We've made a couple runs on them this season, and they always have an answer. So it's going to be a battle the whole game, and I know it's going to be close till the end. We just have to match up well, know the scout, and if we've come out like we did against Sacred Heart, I definitely think we have a great chance to win it all.
Before I let you go, I wanted to ask you about the 100-point game against Fairleigh Dickinson, it was a game where I think you and a bunch of other players were under the weather, yet it was your best offensive game of the season. So do we need you guys to catch the flu before this championship game, or what happened?
I guess that's just a reflection of how deep we can go and how many weapons we really have.
How difficult was it to get through that game?
I thought I was okay, and then I ran up and down the floor like three times, and I was like, oh, I need a sub. I can't do it. And then Lex was sick, Haley was sick, I think Kelly was sick for a little, the coaches were all sick. But I mean, the freshmen, the sophomores, people on the bench stepped up and did a tremendous job. So I mean, it didn't hurt us at all.
And last question, what would it mean to you to bring another championship back to Loretto?
It would mean the world. I mean, to get another ring, to get to be celebrating and celebrate with the community and get the attention from everyone, I don't know. It's just an unbelievable feeling to know that the hard work we put in the beginning of the season and the summer has paid off. And I would like to win for the seniors and my teammates and, of course, Joe and the coaches. Just, I don't know. It would be amazing.
Well, Allie, thank you for joining us, and best of luck to you.
Thank you very much.
So, Jasmine, March 17th has been the target date for your team all season long. It's finally upon us.
Yes, it's
so
here.
What does this day and this opportunity mean to you?
It's very exciting, very overwhelming. You know, this is the first step to many, you know, in the future. And I think with the group that we have something really special. And tomorrow is a really big day for us, and we look to make history and do something that's never been done before. So we're really excited.
Now, they say the journey makes the destination all that much sweeter. Mm-hmm. So going on this journey with this special team and the ladies that you have in the locker room, you know, how has this journey been to get to this destination?
It has been unreal. I mean, back in the summer, we went to Italy. That's when our journey really began with all 15 of us. And we got to know everyone. We got to know each other. We started to bond. And it's just carried onto the court. It's carried throughout the season. And I think it's really shown like all our potential from, you know, the beginning back in the summer. And now March 17th is here, and we're here to do what we've planned on since the summertime. And at that point in time, it was just, you know, a vision, and now it's actually here. So it's been amazing. I wouldn't trade anything. or any of my teammates.
Now, Coach was telling me that it was around that time when you went over to Italy that she introduced the way that you guys were going to play, where everybody contributes. Now, at first, was everybody on board with that, or did it take a couple games, a couple practices for everybody to see, oh, Coach might be onto something?
Yeah, here. At first, we weren't really, like, feeling it, but, like, at the end of the day, we were just like, it works, like... It worked, so we all bought into it.
The proof is in the pudding, right?
It really. We bought into it. We all knew exactly what we had to do. You know, we in Italy, we did the 5 and 5 out, and we were like, oh, this might just be because we're in Italy and everyone's playing. But then games started, and we actually started doing that, and we were like, whoa, what is this? But, it works, and it's great, you know. Go in, go hard for 3 minutes, and then the next five are in. So it's been great.
Now, speaking about going hard, in the two games where your team has had the most at stake this year, the regular season title clincher at Sacred Heart and then the semifinal here on Wednesday against Mount St. Mary's, it's been you kind of leading the way, putting the team on your shoulders and coming through when your team needs the big basket. So, you know, how are you able to come through and perform like that in those kind of situations?
I just feel like, you know, my team can trust me in certain situations like that. And, you know, I feel like they're there for me, so I have to be there for them. And the game's on the line. I'm sorry, I'm not trying to lose. So I'll do whatever it takes to, you know, get that win, so.
Now, for this championship game against St. Francis, you played them twice during the regular season. What are some challenges that they present?
Allie Williams is definitely, she's going to be a challenge, but I think if we can, you know, keep her to a minimum amount of points and just defend. We have to defend, we have to rebound, we have to get on the floor with loose balls. We have to determine the outcome of this game. We can't let them come in here and try and speed us up and make us go crazy. We just have to do what we've been doing for the past 6 months, and after those 40 minutes, hopefully we'll be cutting down the net, so.
I wanted to talk about that for a second, because I was at the regular season title clincher. After the game, it was just handshakes, business as usual. I was here Wednesday. Maybe there was a hug in there somewhere, but it was mostly handshakes.
Yeah.
So are you guys waiting to burst loose for this championship? Can we see more than handshakes on Sunday, perhaps?
You will see. Yeah. The thing is, all those things that we've gotten so far are great, but that's not what we want. That's not our ultimate goal. We want a championship. Getting the regular season title and clinching this or that, like, that's great, but tomorrow is what it's about. I will be bawling. I just want to win so bad. We all want it so bad. I'm really excited for tomorrow, like, very excited. I hope everyone storms the court. I've never had that experience. Like, growing up, I've always seen it. Like, you can see on that wall back there, like, all those people. I've never experienced a stadium that's like filled with people, so I'm like really excited for tomorrow and what it'll bring. So.
Well, we're excited for as well.
Thank
should
you.
Be a packed
thank
house, and,
yes.
and best of luck to
thank
you.
Thank you very much.
That was Allie Williams, first team all conference performer for St. Francis. Jasmine Martin, third team all conference performer for Quinnipiac. Both should be on the all tournament team by the time the night's over, but only one will be on the championship winning team. As we get set for Championship Sunday, we're taking you up to the top of the hour here on ESPN Front, here on NEC Front Row Live before ESPNU takes over. It's the first ever championship game, NEC Women's Basketball Championship game here at the TD Bank Sports Center. Home teams, not including when the finals are held at neutral sites, are 15-6 here in the championship round. The last road team to win the championship on the road away from home was St. Francis at LIU back in 2010. Now, Coach, one thing I liked about Jasmine Martin, she made no bones about it. She's looking forward to celebrating here tonight. And what during shoot-around today, she was out there. They were fixing the nets. They had a ladder up there. They were fixing the nets, and Jasmine Martin comes out and told the gentleman on the ladder, keep the ladder out here. We might need it a little later on tonight. I mean, there's a ton of confidence right now with the Quinnipiac Bobcats.
Actually, the way they've played all year long, I'd be completely confident in what we can do, especially in this building. They've had a great run. I think the thing that they can always go back to is the balance with their program and their team, so that you don't have to really rely on any one player. But somebody's going to step up. That's what they believe to help them win a game.
And for Allie Williams, you know, she is all into the history and tradition. She's aware of it. She's been to the NCAA tournament before. She knows what it means to, you know, be at this stage and get the job done.
Well, you know, you love when players understand what came before them and then what they have to live up to. And what just a terrific young lady, both young ladies are. But Allie Williams, since I've seen her play since she was a freshman, just following and covering the league. And she has grown every single year. And, you know, I don't think you can stop her one-on-one. And she is just taking this team on her back and carrying them to this championship game.
Now, as I told her in that interview, I had her as the player of the year. Obviously, it doesn't mean anything. I didn't have a vote. But I thought, you know, Artemis Benu had a fantastic season. Take nothing away. She led the nation in rebounding. I mean, take nothing away from that. But if she wasn't on Robert Morris, they probably still don't make the playoffs. If you take, you know, Felicia Barron away from Quinnipiac, they still have a good team. You take Allie Williams away from St. Francis, we're talking an entirely different group.
Well, I just love the way she handled that. You know, she was so gracious towards Artemis Benu and the kind of year that she had. And you know what? I think she'll trade all of that for a championship.
Absolutely. Maybe even a tournament MVP, as we talked about with her in that interview. All right, Coach, it's time to break things down.
Sure.
Get out the chalkboard. Let's talk about some keys to the game. First, for St. Francis, if they're going to come out of this hostile environment in Hamden, Connecticut with their 12th championship trophy, what do they need to do?
Well, I think first and foremost, they have to take care of the basketball in their first game out at St. Francis. They had 31 turnovers that turned into 29 Quinnipiac points. So they have to take care of the ball. And then they have to make sure that they know where Felicia Barron is. She has caused them problems at both ends of the floor. And this way they can get into the flow of their offense. And the last thing is to hound Jillian Abshire. Everything flows for Quinnipiac through their point guard. She sets up their offense. She gets everybody involved. So I think that you'll see them today. I think you'll see them double team her, try to keep the ball out of her hands, and let somebody else initiate and run things for the Quinnipiac Bobcats.
Now on the other side, what are some keys for their opponents here today?
I think the biggest thing for Quinnipiac is to really rattle the St. Francis guards. A little bit young, when you look at after you go Nakia Gibbs, you know, you've got Rebecca Sparks, who's a freshman. You got Hayward, who's a sophomore, and you know they haven't been in this position before. Right. So they really have to get after their guards. The other thing is to limit, if you can, limit Adams' touches. Now, I don't think you can not have her touch the basketball, but I'm like, keep her off the board. She's a tremendous offensive rebounder. And anytime she starts to drive, you have to know where she is. You just can't let her get 30 tonight. And then the last thing I look at is stay aggressive if you're the Bobcats. You know, all year long, you're shooting threes. You're really getting after defensively. I just say stay with the game plan and still be aggressive throughout this entire game.
Now, Allie Williams is a special player because she can beat you both ways. You know, some teams try to double her. If you do that, she's very good at distributing the basketball. She has a lot of assists this year. Teams can shoot, you know, threes, mid-range jumpers. If you leave her man-to-man, well, she could take it right to the basket. You know, she's a havoc on the defensive end as well. She has, you know, one of the top steal players in the NEC this year. So, you know, Quinnipiac, you know, they went man-to-man in both games this season. Cameron Warner had some fantastic games. Sam Guastella was out for both games against St. Francis this year. I think she's going to be in there as well, trying to man-to-man Ostergaard. So, how do you think that strategy for Coach Rupert going man-to-man with Allie Williams is going to play today?
Well, you know, the interesting thing there is that if you're doubling her, although I would like to see her, if she's especially posting up in smaller guards, you could double there because she can get going. But if you keep her in front and you make her have to play, what she's saying is she's going to make other people on the St. Francis team have to score. And they've really been doing a really nice job with that. So, you know, I think you have to know where she is at all times. You have to make her shots difficult. You're shooting a jumper, you've got to contest her. But my big thing for her is keep her off the offensive glass. If she shoots and misses, just don't let her get the basketball. But I'm sure, Coach Rupert wants to have to see other players from St. Francis have to step up tonight because she doesn't want Allie Williams beating her.
Another interesting thing that St. Francis brings to the table is a press. They come out with a lot of press.
Sure.
And I think that goes into what you were saying about Boo Abshire, how, you know, being calm, cool, collected, not making that bad pass to turn it over, you know, with the press on you. You know, I think that's going to be a big key today as well.
Well, what we saw most of the year from St. Francis, they run like a 2-2-1 or a 1-2-1-1, mostly a 2-2-1 zone press. What you saw them do their last two games, especially against Sacred Heart, was they went to a player-to-player pressure. And they tried to keep the ball out of Norman's hands from Sacred Heart. Did a nice job. I think you'll see them do the same exact thing with Abshire today and even double her in the press so that somebody else has to take care of the ball. You know, again, you're trying to throw Quinnipiac off guard, trying to get them off balance and out of an offensive sink because once they get going, they're the leading, you know, they score 71, 72 points a game. They lead the NEC in scoring. So
these are the top two teams in
scoring. Yeah, absolutely. So anything that you can do to distract and to make them do things out of character, if you're St. Francis, I think it'll help you today in this championship game.
And now an interesting question. We know that this game is for the NEC Championship Trophy. It's for an automatic berth to the NCAA tournament. A lot of stakes here. Right. But for Quinnipiac, 29-2, trying to win their 21st game in a row. If not, it would be 20 games in a row. But if they don't win today, is this a team that, you know, has a chance maybe at an at-large?
Well, you know, their RPI is right around 43. Their strength of schedule is 202 when you're looking at all Charlie Cream's, you know, bracketology. I think the winner today is going to the NCAA tournament. So I think this is where they're at. I think they have to win today to go to a championship game. You look around the country, there have only been one or two upsets where people have not, like, you know, St. Joe's just beats Fordham. Now, Fordham beat St. Joe's last night. You know, you're looking at, then you're probably have to take St. Joe's. So there haven't been, you know, the people staying in line so that there's not that chance. But I think right now, and again, this is something that the Northeast Conference wants to do better than they have in the past. I think their RPI as a league is down from where it was last year, which now hurts Quinnipiac a little bit. So I think the winner today, you got to win today to go to the NCAA tournament.
I agree. I think if they had last year's RPI in
Could
the league,
be a possibility.
Last year's non-conference schedule for Quinnipiac with this year's results at 29-2, I think they would have had a better case. I'm going to agree with you, but hey, you never know. You know, we can have the people who make those decisions, the committee that could be watching this game, and maybe they're impressed. You never know.
Hey, listen, you can't take anything away from Quinnipiac. Obviously, to get this point, would you look at this season not being a success if they don't win? Quite possible, right? They say you have to get that ring in order to make it all happen. But they've
doesn't
had
mean
just
a thing
a
if you
great,
don't have that ring.
A great, great season. But, you know, you got to do it out on the court, and you got to make things happen today in the next 40 minutes.
As you see on your screen, we're under 3 minutes away. What's going to happen is we're going to step aside for a little bit once the clock hits zero. We had a great thing. The players actually, coming off the court from practice, they actually sat down with us and talked a little bit about what it would mean for them to win the NEC Championship. So we're going to see that video while we have the national anthem here at the TD Bank Sports Center, and then Phyllis and I will come back after that with our predictions, final thoughts, and then we'll send you off to ESPNU. Just want to talk a little bit about the all-time series, because it's been rather interesting. St. Francis has historically dominated the all-time series 17-10. They've won both games in the playoffs. The 2004 semifinals, that was the Ashley Kelly, Beth Swink duel that went to St. Francis. Tanji Ward had a big game in that one to lead the Red Flash into the championship game. And then they met in a rematch in 2005, a little bit wider margin of victory for the Red Flash. But this year, Quinnipiac turned things around. It was their first season sweep of the Red Flash since 2008. They met January 21st in Loretto, the game Phyllis mentioned, when the Red Flash turned the ball over 31 times. Felicia Barron had an incredible game with 28 points to lead the way for the Bobcats in an 81-69 victory. They met a little less than a month later here in Hamden, a little bit closer, 61-50. It was one of just seven games this year that the Bobcats trailed at halftime, but they put together a 15-0 run led by Boo Abshire and Felicia Barron to come away with the win. Barron finished with 18 points to lead the way. So, Coach, if you look at some of the players, we know about Jasmine Martin, we know about Allie Williams, but Felicia Barron's going to have an incredible role in this game either way. And as you mentioned, a player like Sparks, a player like Hayward, they're going to have to come up big for St. Francis.
Well, they can't leave it all on Allie Williams' shoulders. And when Sparks came up with the game at Sacred Heart, scored 27 points, you know, you can almost take a step back if you're Williams, but if Sparks is scoring that way or Gibbs scoring that way, but I see Hayward being a big key here today to really stretch the defense. They're not going to be paying as much attention to her as they would to Williams, as they will, you know, to Nikia Gibbs. So, you know, Hayward has some experience as a sophomore. If she gets hot, she's a very streaky shooter. You look for her to shoot the ball well today, and that could really help St. Francis.
She had a big game earlier this year in a rivalry game against Robert Morris, where she was shooting the three ball really, really well. Coach Hay was telling me that she was coming out trying to do that every single game since then. It hasn't exactly worked out, but you never know. Today could be your day.
Well, you really have to let the game come to you. I think you'll see both teams, as we get started, try to feel each other out, try to figure out what someone's trying to do to them, and then work from there. But as you say, as a coach, you have to, you know, you have to go with what brought you here. And that's going to Allie Williams if you're St. Francis. That's getting better guard play out of somebody in their back, or whether it's Hayward, whether it's Gibbs, whether it's Sparks. Dugan had a terrific game against Sacred Heart, so maybe she can step up, but somebody else is going to have to score for St. Francis to come away with a victory today.
Well, this is what it's all about right here, the NEC Championship Trophy and that automatic ticket into the NCAA tournament. We're just moments away from the national anthem. We're moments away from going live on ESPNU. But before we do that, let's check in with some of the key players in today's contest and check in what it would mean for them to win the NEC Championship.
I mean, as a senior, I think it would be just absolutely unbelievable to go out with, to get a ring.
I really can't describe it.
And just to win it, it would just show that we can get through anything as a team.
It would be amazing, because as a little girl, you dream of going to the big dance.
So it would really just mean that everything that we've done ever since we were little girls and since we've been here, it would all be worth it.
We've been working so hard in the offseason.
We've done countless hours practicing and working with each other.
And we've worked so hard.
I think all of our hard work would, you know, finally show what we can do.
Another NEC Championship.
We have two under our belt already, so one more would just be that much more exciting.
For us, it would just mean the world.
It would mean everything.
It would mean everything.
It would mean everything, especially to me and this whole team.
If we can bring another one in, I'm sure the school will love it, and then we will love it too.
It's all we've ever wanted.
I've thought about climbing up the ladder and cutting down the net.
Just putting it all out on the table. I think that's the most important thing.
You're watching NEC Front Row Live, brought to you by Pilot Pen. It's time now for the starting lineups. Let's go right into it. First for the St. Francis Red Flash. They start three guards, two forwards, beginning with Nakia Gibbs, freshman Rebecca Sparks, who had 27 points in the semifinals. Alexa Hayward, then up front, veterans from the NCAA tournament and the NEC championship game, Shanae Fleming and Allie Williams. Fleming, Williams, Gibbs were all part of that 2011 championship team. Don't underestimate experience here today. On the other side, we have the Quinnipiac Bobcats. They've operated the same lineup since February the 12th in a game against Sacred Heart. Abshire, Barron, Martin, McQueen, and Warner, and also we should mention the Gold Rush unit because they see just as much time. Liebeck, Cannon, Ostergaard, Carroll, and Guastella. All right, Coach, it's that time. We're right here, moments away from going live on ESPNU. You got to make a prediction. Who do you like and who's the MVP?
I like the Quinnipiac Bobcats. I think their strength is their balance and their depth. I think Jillian Abshire is that absolute key to the game. She gets this team going. She makes them steady. And she really has done a terrific job all year long. And then I think just too much Felicia Barron and Jasmine Martin. I'll go with Jasmine Martin because I believe that she's really a big game player and she'll come up big in big games. I think her big game is tonight.
The two games where they've had the most on the line, it's been Jasmine Martin coming through, and obviously there's a lot on the line here today. Quinnipiac looking to complete the perfect conference season. The Red Flash are looking for title number 12. It's just about that time. Coming up right now on ESPNU, Kara Capuano and Brooke Weisbrod will have the call. Don't forget, as soon as the ESPNU cameras go off the air, we'll be right back here courtside and handed for all the post-game festivities with a special post-game edition of NEC Front Row Live. So now from Hamden, we say so long for now. For Coach Phyllis Mangina, Marc Robbins, and our entire PAC Network crew, I'm Craig D'Amico. Enjoy the 2013 NEC Women's Basketball Championship game, and we'll see you right back here afterwards, live on NEC Front Row.